Hey everyone, welcome back to another video here on the RC Explained channel. In this particular video, we're going to be taking a look at how do you correctly dispose of a lithium polymer battery pack. But first, how do you actually know when it's time to call it quits on the pack and get rid of it? Well, we're going to go through each of these areas, and we're going to first start off with identifying when it's time to get rid of the pack. So I would say there are two specific reasons as to why you would actually want to get rid of a battery pack. The first and more obvious answer is there's damage to the battery. This damage could come from the battery pack being involved in a vehicle that was in a collision or crash, and you now have actual physical damage on the pack. Or another reason that the pack has physical damage to it is because it has ballooned. Maybe the battery was pushed too hard or stressed in a certain way, and a couple or even one cell within it ended up expanding. An expanded cell or even a physically damaged cell is not good to continue operating. When it comes to these physically damaged battery packs, the reason why you would like to get rid of them is because it poses a risk for further damage. Perhaps the battery gets to a point where it calls it quits for you and then bursts into flames. This is the exact reason we want to avoid that scenario, and we just put the battery down instead. The second reason is performance oriented. Once the battery pack no longer performs as it should and you can no longer run it in your radio control vehicle, you have a couple options. The first and obvious one is to dispose of that battery pack. The second option is downgrade that pack into a lesser, weaker radio controlled vehicle. In some cases, I take the battery packs that come out of my radio controlled electric ducted fan jets that pull well over 90 amps or so, and I place them into vehicles that pull at least half of that amount of current, and then the packs get another couple years of lifespan. This is one option that you have, and if you don't have a radio controlled vehicle that you could toss the weaker battery packs into and you deem that the pack has no value, then it's time to dispose of that battery. So now let's take a look at that process. We essentially have three options to choose from, where the first option is actually going to be relatively simple. So now the first thing I would recommend for option one, or for any of the options that we're going to be talking about in this video, is to take a look at your local laws, regulations, and rules. Depending on what kind of local regulations you have, you may have to do certain things with the battery pack. In some cases, you may be able to take the battery pack as is. All you need to do is grab your pack, you don't even need to discharge it, you cut the lead off so that you don't have this one, then you take some tape, you wrap it around the ends of the wires so that that pack cannot short itself out. Once you have those leads taped off so that they cannot short out from each other, then you can take that to the recycler that accepts the pack in that form and let them worry about the next steps that they have to take for that lithium polymer battery pack. Now let's talk about the other two options that we have in order to recycle the battery pack, bring it to the local recyclers. So what I prefer to do to keep things fairly safe is take the battery pack and get it down to 0 volts. I know once the pack is at 0 volts, there's no real energy that can cause damage by shorting out and explode or burn or cause any sorts of fires. This is the way that I would prefer, and this is how I actually take it to the local recyclers. So let's go through that, and I'll show you the exact process that you can use in two different ways. One is going to be through your own charger, if your charger in fact has all of these capabilities. Let's take a look at what that looks like. First thing that we do is we plug the battery pack that we want to dispose of into our charger, and we connect the balance tap into our charger as well. Now that we have that plugged all in, we can set the battery down and select our function that will allow discharge. So the first thing on this screen that we want to select is voltage. We're going to drop this down to 3.00 volts, and that will allow us to discharge all the cells within the pack to that level. Then the next thing that we want to do is select our current, and we're going to leave this as a 1C discharge, which represents 2.2 amps because this pack is a 2200 milliamp hour pack. Now there are a couple different ways that we can get down to that 3.00 volt mark. This is one way where we can go and have a consistent single charge, and we're going to go through another method. This other method is has its own advantages, and that advantage is we can go and discharge very rapidly, very quick, down to about the 3.50 volt mark. I went a little bit past. I want to drop down to 3.50 volts, and we're going to go and jump the current up to a high amount. Now the charger can discharge at 10 amps, but it is limited by voltage, so we'll probably get about a 7 amp discharge or so. Now the benefit from this is that from 3.50 volts to 3.00 volts, the internal resistance of the battery pack tends to increase. And when it increases, this is going to mean there's going to be more heat for us, and we can have exposure to the pack ballooning and becoming a little bit more dangerous, and we want to avoid this. That's why we discharge really quickly to the 3.50 volt mark, and then we go and we're going to slow it down from 3.50 to the 3.00 mark. So here we are, we're now back into our settings where we can drop this now to 3.00 volts now that we have actually hit 3.50 volts per cell. But we're going to take the current now down to about an amp or so. This will allow us to discharge at a relatively slow rate. And as we're going through this process, we just want to monitor temperatures and make sure that nothing's ever overheating. If something does overheat, simply stop the charging or discharging cycle. And we don't need to see the rest of the cycle there. All we know is that it's going to go down to 3.00 volts. And from here, we can use a different method so that we can continue on with our process. Let's take a look at exactly what that looks like. First thing that we do is we get back into our discharge function and we select a nickel metal hydride 6S battery pack. Now it's important that you select a nickel metal hydride battery because a LiPo charger will not discharge past 3.00 volts, or for some chargers 2.80 volts. We select a 6S as I know that this battery charger will actually start to discharge. Your charger may not, and you may have to select a nickel metal hydride 5S battery. Now you did see us select a voltage of 0.1 volts. This is the voltage that we want to discharge the battery pack to. Being a 6S pack, we're going to be able to discharge to 0.6 volts at the bottom end of our range here. And now you can see that the voltage of our battery is actually declining very rapidly. This is more than likely not going to happen with your battery. It's going to take some time to discharge through the point from 6.0 volts down to that 0 volt mark. And as you're going through this process, you will want to measure the temperature every couple minutes just to make certain that nothing is getting out of control. As batteries go through this lower type of voltage that we're dealing with, the internal resistance tends to increase significantly, and we want to avoid any issues. You may ask, why are we not using a LiPo-safe bag? Well, we don't use this LiPo-safe bag because we want to be measuring the temperature so that we can avoid even getting to something that could possibly be dangerous. And if we do see temperatures increasing, here we're seeing about 27.0 degrees, if temperatures were to get out of control, we simply just terminate the discharge. Now let's talk about our third option. Our third option comes in as soon as we have our battery pack and all the cells within it at 3.00 volts per cell. Once we're there, then we can start and begin the process for option three. Let's take a look at exactly what that is. Our third option uses a bunch of water, this bucket, and the battery pack. We also need to use salt. The whole idea is that we're going to make this solution that allows the battery pack to discharge in our solution. So here you can see that the battery nicely fits at the very bottom, and all the wires can actually be tucked down nice and tight to the bottom of this bucket. The next thing we want to do is put about a liter of water into our bucket. This is going to be the first 500 milliliters that goes into the bucket. Then what we're going to do is go fill our measuring cup back up and get another half liter, and we can bore that into our bucket. Now the next thing that we have to do is we want to measure out about 30 to 35 grams of salt or so, and we want to place that into our water solution. Now we have to do that because salt actually allows the water to be conductive. Water on its own is not actually conductive until we put any impurities into it. So now that we have the water and salt solution and we mix it up a little bit, we can then put our battery pack at the very bottom and make sure that it's fully submerged under all of the water. Now it can begin to discharge for us. When it comes to our water solution, there's a couple advantages and a couple disadvantages. The advantage is it's quite easy, there's nothing really to worry about, and it's probably one of the safest ways to actually discharge a battery pack. The disadvantage is that it's going to take a very long time. You're probably looking at having that battery pack in the solution for at least 2 to 3 weeks. And at the end of those 2 to 3 weeks, you'd be lucky to have a battery pack that has hit the magic 0.00 volts. You're probably going to still have a little bit of charge remaining in that battery pack. Now, there are some other clever ways to get our battery packs fully discharged once you've brought it down to that 3.00 volts per cell mark. And that is with the means of using something like a light bulb wired in so that it has a connector that can connect right into your own battery pack. This is definitely a viable option. The only thing you want to make certain of is that the power that's going to be consumed by this light bulb or whatever load you choose to use here is going to pull less than about 100 or 200 milliamps. Anything more, and I would consider that as a little bit too much because heat tends to build up very quickly when you get below that 3.00 volt threshold. One of the last things that I do, whether I'm using the water solution or I'm using my discharger to discharge the pack all the way down to almost 0.00 volts, is I'll take the pack and I'll actually short circuit and jump the main lead. So here I have a positive lead going and shorting itself out to the negative lead. What this means for the battery pack is that this pack has to be at 0.00 volts. The big thing here is after a few days, I take those leads off of the battery pack and that pack will remain at 0.00 volts, indicating to me that there is no power and everything is safe to properly dispose of. Now, using any of those last few methods, all I need to do now is take the battery pack that's at 0.00 volts confirmed and take it to the local recycler. Now, in my case, at my local recycler, I don't have to pay for this. I simply drop the packs off with them and they handle it from there. Well, guys, that pretty well does it for this video. I hope that gives you a good understanding as to how to get rid of these packs when they come to the end of their life. As always, like the video. If you do, don't forget to hit that sub button so that I can see you in the next video. Thanks a lot for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.